thanks for inviting me to moderate this session on society. I mean, I think the whole event has an extremely good lineup of speakers and topics. So I'm very glad to be here together with Konstantin Dullaart and Stephan Dillemuth. So now we're kind of getting ready, or we just had the real lunch bites, right? So I hope that you're all kind of ready for restarting the sessions and getting into all these topics. Again, as Melanie said, a very broad stream, society, but in the more specific instructions for what kind of questions we should address in this session, she also wrote, which I think is in the official panel description, and I quote, "This panel focuses on artistic strategies of resistance in response to present mechanisms of control." So, I mean, in other words, we're tapping into some of the current big issues when it comes to discussing relations between between questions of power, technology, and society. Just to comment a little bit on this as an intro before I introduce the speakers. I mean, I think these kind of discussions are usually, and I'm talking now more about in the everyday media and mainstream debates, dominated by very simplified perspectives on either how digitization is impacting society in different ways. I mean, we had the digital revolution, right? Nowadays we have the industry 4.0 discussion that happens on various levels, from government to business fairs like the CeBIT recently. Then, I mean, this is a bit simplified, but still giving a kind of perspective here. There is this other kind of more social shaping of technology direction, where we try to perhaps look then at technology as something that we can shape according to different ideas of what kind of society we want to have, and technology more as a means to kind of achieve that. Peer-to-peer or common-based production models, different kind of more social visions of technology would be examples of that part of the debate. And I guess in more kind of critically informed net political debates, both of these perspectives or these directions of are complementary when we discuss surveillance, security, privacy, transparency regulation, and so forth. We will deal, I guess, with such questions in the panel and in the discussion, but from, I would dare to say, or hope, a more skewed perspective that has to do, on the one hand, in general, with the perspective of this event, an art and digital culture event, focusing on artistic practices, but also, of course, from the point of view of the specific work of Konstantin and Stefan. This connects to a lot of the things that has already been said. I think today, I mean, we had Ben Vickers talking about this interior and the problematics of inside and outside. Also in the last session, there was this discussion about specifically that. And it's very relevant to this discussion about mechanisms of control. Because when I say skewed perspective, I think, you know, we are not able to discuss those mechanisms from some kind of ideal outside perspective at all today. We're very much, we have to acknowledge that we're all under the influence already, so to speak. So, of course, a contingent perspective on mechanisms of control is a starting point, which I think both of the speakers in different dynamic ways connect to when we discuss then resistant practices from kind of ambiguous inside-outside positions, where resistance is probably more like an ongoing attempt to transform our behavior and attitudes towards existing technology rather than the attempt to try and give it some kind of radical other form. And I cannot refrain to refer then in this discussion also to the last Transmediale festival and the edition that came to a close here in Hakavir not so long time ago at the beginning of February with the title Capture All. Maybe it's how many people were at the festival, so I don't make like an embarrassing repeating of everything was said there. It's not that many. Good. Yeah. Okay. So the main thesis of the the festival this year, Transmediale, an art and digital culture festival, it departed from this titled Capture All, which was trying to deal with this phenomena of the idea of the full take or the collected all idea, which drive the data surveillance agendas of agencies like the NSA or the GCHQ, and yeah, I guess we could say also the BND here in Germany, which plays out also, I think, more like a symptom of how digital culture functions today, like a game of data collection and constant extraction of value from all processes of life, everyday life, which is replicated not only through corporations, but also, I think, by ourselves in a by a political way, how we become conduits of data, self-observers, self-optimizers. So quantification and datafication have, to some extent, become instruments, of course, to reinforce power and economic structures over others, make us all happily accept them by enlivening them with our own passionate, open and free, so to speak, interactions within them. So I think in this we need to have new concepts for taking responsibility for and working with data away from this kind of optimization discourse, and it's usually quite fake promises of individual as well as collective power. So it leads also, I just wanted to go into this perspective because it leads also to the question of course, if art have any meaningful resistant capability or to formulate alternatives and alternative practices. If we take this symptom, we take this thesis of capture all or the collected all, the full take logic, take it somehow at face value as kind of functioning of digital capitalism today, then I think there is very little hope to overcome this machine, because the full take is also something that is actually impossible. It rests in an effort that can have no end. So the more data you collect, the more data and the more metadata you actually produce. So we are dealing with a kind of procedural operation, like a computer game. It's based in a looping logic. It's like this kind of cybernetic feedback loops now looping back on themselves in a way. So the kind of control that arises is definitely not a totalitarian hard one in this way. It's a soft or liquid surveillance, as Sigmund Bauman and David Lyons also called it. And that perhaps makes it also even more chillingly effective, since it tries to actually foreclose not only the existing, but also the possible. I'd like to call this kind of idea of the full take as a self-unfulfilling prophecy. It repressively maintains and manages regimes of control at the same time as it unfulfills promises of stability, security, prosperity, freedom, and etc. Soon come to close here. So the thesis maybe that we could also discuss is if this kind of impossibility of this kind of complete capture of everything through the digital is also, it's inherent futility and many failed predictions, which I think we can agree on that it usually also fails, that these can serve as entry points for critique and for the constructions of these alternatives then. So in the abundance of information, capture itself increasingly misfires, and this perpetual failure can also be exploited. So art also works in these kind of blind spots and is perhaps itself also paradoxically a blind spot. And quantification by necessity has its limits because it is a process of delimiting. I think this also will connect to the question of ambiguity. I think probably both presentations will deal with the ambiguity between kind of open and closed that is just not an effect but also expressively claimed or implicitly performed in critical art practices today. And that leads me to the first speaker. I will introduce the speakers right before they speak, so to speak, so Constant will introduce after Stephan. So Stephan Dillemuth is an artist based in Munich. He's also a professor there at the Academy of Visual Arts. His practice covers a broad range of topics and media, there's a list of different media he works in, which feels very ubiquitous to list here. But I would say that he's especially focusing on topics of self-organization, education, resisting also the streamlining of the public sphere into some kind of economized and neoliberal site of control. He has various projects also that form online resource pools like Lebensreform that trace the history of alternative movements and projects for alternative life organization. He's founded various spaces and projects like Friesenwahl in Cologne, Friesenwahl 120, and the, in the 90s the alternative TV project UTV. And if you want to look into his current work, he has a very comprehensive website, controlsociety.com, right? Societyofcontrol.com, yeah. Stefan's talk today will be held under the title of Encrypt Yourself, discussing current situation of surveillance and control from the point of view of our practices that to some extent already have a long history of being encrypted and being carried out in secret spaces at the same time as they kind of ambiguously exist in the open or in the public. So please welcome Stephan Dillemuth.
Geburt above the Bach Nubun, La BDB's event to gentlemen. I buy Fubut La Bike to Booth the Bank, special Balibi, the Geburt of it, events to be to boot, event, maybe Lava Nibi, event, I buy Babantabet. So, yes, since Kristoffer already said a lot of things that I also would like to say, I wanted to share some observations that I had like in the break here when I looked at the model of this building here. Which is, as you know, called the oyster. I saw not an oyster, but a flesh-eating plant. Because it's also like this. And then I started to see ourselves inside of that, trapped on the stage and trapped in the audience. And then I saw my other observation that I see also in seminars and and lectures in the academy, that a lot of you people are so fond of your new tools and devices that you even during a talk like this constantly also work. That means you're answering your emails, you're chatting, and basically with that you're constantly connected and you're producing maybe, it's not the right word in English, but in German you would say permanent sekretieren. Alle here. That means you give secrets. Is it the right word in English?
No.
Secret? Yeah? Is it the same word? Yeah? So you're constantly secreting into this kind of other world which we call the net, which became part of us so much that you, as I said, have the desire to constantly feed it. And that work that you do is obviously permanently also assessed and permanently filtered and profiled and observed, and your productivity increases and it helps other people to increase their productivity as well. So yeah, that was my first just comment here, and that's why I wanted to talk in a way about questions. If you are not so happy with these kind of constantly feeding other machines and workflows, just want to maybe keep things to yourself, to your own attention span, or also to this, what communication means, to create a kind of, a kind of enclosed space, the space between friends, the friend-to-friend network. Then, if you want to sort of maintain that, you think maybe about encryption. And that comes the first and last survey here. How many people think that this matters, encryption? and the question of two. A few more, let's say, double as much, that is, I guess, 20. 40 people in this room care about their own communication networks, the others obviously don't. And how many of you, 20, that means 40, obviously, because not everyone, I mean the radical ones, of course, don't live their own. but how many, now the radical ones included, use PGP? One, two, three, four, five. Okay, yeah. Pretty good privacy. But who would like to know how this works? Yeah. To keep your privacy? Oh, that's more. Oh, cool. Yeah. Well, you know, the good message is it's totally easy. And if you Google PGP, there are a lot of how-tos in the internet. With your machine, it's totally easy, you know, and in the end you answer your email like you normally answer the email, but then you have an end-to-end encryption that is, despite now the big rumor and the full take you mentioned and so forth, you know, I see in this kind of, and I'm going too heavily into this totalitarianism that the whole thing includes and the paranoia that it produces, but on the other hand, I also warn maybe to eat everything out of the hand that says, you know, we can basically decrypt everything and therefore you don't even start to think about encryption. It's not the case. Pretty good privacy is pretty good. And you saw it in the Snowden case, it works. Yeah. So, that's the first message. If I talk about, basically encryption is a language that we don't understand, a language that is only understood by those who use it and who want to protect this kind of communication context. to translate means to encrypt and to decrypt. I use encryption here in this talk more as a metaphor, but also as a practice. I use encryption for making of a code and for the making of a code, that is encryption in the strict sense, and also for hiding information, which is more steganography. So one thing is to make a code that you cannot, or hopefully only those that you, it's determined for can read it, and the other thing is to hide information. You are looking at the image as well, right? So go to the next one. But I also want to use the question of encryption versus openness in perspective of Bohemian and the grassroots context, because I think that these spheres are closed or opaque spaces anyway. The salons, the smoking zones, in former times, the coffee houses, maybe the dark rooms, the chat rooms, the dark net, of course, friend-to-friend networks have always been the site of Bohemia and their communication. And works of art can also see as an encrypted message. They are ambiguous to read and not necessarily open for anyone else, for everybody's reading. And yet art is always the place where this kind of meaning, the Bohemia is the place where this kind of meaning is made. And nevertheless, of these kind of closures, art is always, at least in the tradition of the Enlightenment, all art has always been an address to the world, hello world, to everyone, basically. This is a seeming contradiction. The closing and the opening of art and knowledge production is something that interests me here. So what I'm basically say or want to say or waiting for is that new concepts, you know, the fact that coffee came to Europe, it created the coffee house, and the coffee house was creating a kind of a communication context, a new way of discussing with each other. So this happens maybe also now to the smoking ban that these places outside
or to smoking in general. And then after maybe the spies sit in the coffee house or after smoking is banned, new forms of communication come from that. And what happens now? We can see maybe three big movements. We see maybe through globalization, homogenization of communication means language, text, and also image. And that comes along with a certain extent of normativity and standardization. English became the lingua franca, we have Twitter, we have CNN and its opponents, we have contemporary art daily. So these are formats of normation. But also within that we can also see processes of differentiation, for example through German, English or Dinglish press releases or through the inclusion of spelling mistakes. We can also see maybe in the process of globalization tendencies back to the region, to the community, to community building, and to slangs, jargons, and new codes, and even dress codes. On the other hand, and maybe we don't have to go too deep in that, it's the fact that Kristoffer has mentioned GCHQ, NSA, BND, total Überwachung, data retention, Vorratsspeicherung, control of metadata and content alike. Profiling, yesterday we heard about that. So basically we are living in a surveillance state that's allegedly democratic and allegedly wants to provide more security, but it results in the opposite, in less democracy and less security. It even undermines existing security with the inclusion of backdoors. And even now there is this big debate in Europe and the US, and the UK actually started it, to forbid encryption software at all. So no one is supposed to be able to encrypt their messages unless there is a backdoor to the NSA included. So that results, of course, also in ideas, maybe in internal processes of internalization, like the Pen Club survey, even before the Charlie Hebdo attack, stated in this survey, Global Chilling, that that impact of mass surveillance on international writers, one out of six writers have self-censored themselves because of this surveillance. So basically we are in a constant paralysis in regards to that, which results maybe in even giving up more from oneself than you must, for example, with Facebook. So you are basically, to end this chapter, you are not only transparent as a citizen, maybe you are not a citizen at all, because you are a subject, bare of civil rights. In general, you are a suspect, paralyzed and sleeping, a possible terrorist in whatever you might think and do. That was showing now the side of the state, but we know that we also have corporate control of communication, of shopping and market research. Like above, we have the idea of total control, but here it comes with a different set of new laws, like a lot of copyright laws, disclaimers, and other things come along with that. So you are not only transparent, a transparent consumer, but you are targeted, to be targeted, but you are also a transparent producer to be exploited. Someone who helps to produce your own exploitation. What results of this is can be observed on a daily level, at least where I'm working, and also in my artistic networks, and it can be subsumed under the name distrust. distrust to all external provision of services and security, distrust in secret services, of course, in state and corporation, distrust in all form of institution. Distrust, but also in social relations, in communication, in talks, in bars, in chats, in theory production, in exhibition contexts. We internalize control, and paralysis becomes mutual control, self-control, like we said in the pen club. Also in the artistic field, I see this paranoia. Hmm? 2 minutes. I'm not even half through. Well, but okay. What? No, no, it's. I told him to interrupt me, actually. So basically, I come to the question of distrust. I also show basically how this distrust enters my professional field as a teacher. That also there is not an distrust in the academy where I teach, from student side and from teacher side, but there's also distrust amongst each other, and I see that as a very typical thing that happens nowadays. And as a paranoid artist, of course, I also have to distrust, for example, this being here on stage and talking in the context of the Goethe Institute and of of the digital agenda and an artistic agenda, and how that would go together, because the German digital politics are so bad, so disgusting, that you cannot believe it. So of course something like this is also about making a good, or could be seen through my paranoid eyes in terms of making a good image, Germany being so much interested in a digital agenda and la la la, theory, art production, and so forth. So, as I said, as an artist, one is either paranoid or numbed down, and I prefer the paranoid version, and therefore I encrypt, and I see basically, to now really speed it up, to, I think, don't see encryption only as PGP and as something that happens in the digital realm. See encryption in that what happens in the arts and in Bohemia in general, in community making, and play it up in a way. It's okay to be paranoid, I think, because then I think that what might happen in these kind of enclosures that are always codified languages, that becomes probably more intensified, this way of communication. It becomes more research-like, and the way of knowledge production and artistic production, I think, gets more and more differentiated in encrypted context, so to speak. But on the other hand, and this is now to the end and important, that this I see only as a counter-strategy. I always think that art, knowledge production, is hello world. That means it is meant to be all. So this is just a strategy to encounter an encryption and a kind of a privatization that happens through enclosure, to just counter that in order to basically share the same tools. And but from it matters then what you do in these contexts, in these kind of encrypted contexts, and the only thing is that you use this kind of new trust and new freedom that encryption provides for creating openness and for creating new communication contexts. So that would be my message, just to be in time.
Thank you, Stephan. Sorry to be such a hardline moderator, but we were starting so late and I didn't cut my intro down, and I didn't actually cut you down. It's it's the conditions we have if we want to finish in time. So now I would like to introduce Constant Dullaart. So Constant is a Dutch artist based in Berlin. And I would like, I think I would describe his work foremostly as comprising of performative interventions into, I refrain to say really the internet, because I think what he's really intervening in is more kind of cultural phenomena related to the internet and kind of digitally mediated systems of communication, representation, and control also. I just want to mention very briefly his recent project in this context, High Retention, Slow Delivery, which maybe we can discuss later, which played out as an intervention into social media. He bought 2.5 fake Instagram followers.
2.5 million.
Yeah, didn't I say million? No, okay. 2.5 million fake Instagram followers, distributed them evenly on selected artists, curators, art world professionals.
Klaas Biesenbach, Hans Urch, Oberist.
We have the list there. Yeah, so that they each would get exactly 100,000 followers. So this project, I think, also demonstrates very well this kind of combined critical and poetical edge in Constant's work. He will speak now on one of these his later pieces, the Manifesto on Balconism. And yeah, please take it away, Constant.
Thank you very much, Kristoffer. And thank you very much for everybody to come out on this day, where spring is almost here. I made very small notes just now. a lot of information is encrypted already, SSL certificates, it's all encryption already. So if we have to talk about encryption and this magic encryption with very little access, I think we need to specify this. And I think this kind of, these times ask for very careful expressions of these qualities, and I think that a lot of communication we have is already encrypted, or either codified languages or just general internet traffic is mostly called encrypted. The only thing is that a lot of people have the keys. So the thing is that if we have encryption with very little people that have the keys, it's actually, as the keynote ended beautifully with yesterday, it's actually access becomes property. And I think in May 2012, I gave away my Facebook profile, which doesn't seem to be like a big thing, but that time it was like kind of I did it in public in the new museum, and it was, I wanted to get rid of my profile, and I wanted to abandon it and see what would happen if I would abandon my profile that was generated by me and in collaboration with Facebook. And a month later, Assange went into the Ecuadorian embassy. So it's weirdly enough, that's in the summer of 2012, so that's a long time. And at that time, I wrote this manifest called Balkanism. So not balkanization, as in the Balkan, but the balcony. So Balkanism, and to kind of emphasize the idea that we would reclaim this environment, and this environment that is now existing, that we're continuously redefining the relationship between public and private. That, for example, Occupy Wall Street was possible in Zuccotti Park just because it was private property and it wasn't public property. These kind of things are very interesting dynamics, and of course now through this kind of encryption debate, this is also again like how much is public and how much is private, how much can be interpreted by private companies, etc. Since Assange is still in the embassy, there's always rumors that he's leaving, but since he's still in the embassy, I would like to, I keep on making new iterations of the manifest, because it remains kind of relevant. And there is a book which has now recently gone into distribution with Motto Distribution, if you're like here in Berlin, whatever. And could you start the audio file?
Because this is the latest version. We are all on the balcony now, standing on a platform made out of a tweet into corporate versions of public space. We are not stored in a cloud, opaque or translucent to whomever. We publish. We get read. However, private publishing does not exist. We now know we always get read. To select what we want to have read and by whom is our greatest challenge for now and in the future. If you tolerate this, your children will be normalized. Outside, on the street, status updates in the air, checking into another spatial analogy of information exchange, sometimes hard to reach, through tutorials, encryptions, and principles. It is generous to be outdoors, watched by a thousand eyes recording us for the future, our actions to be interpreted as an office job. We need a private veranda above ground, a place for a breath of fresh air, out of sight for the casual onlooker, but great for public announcements. The balcony is both public and private, online and offline. It is a space and a movement at the same time. You can be seen or remain unnoticed, inside and outside. Slippers are okay on the balcony. Freedom through encryption, rather than openness. The most important thing is, you must choose to be seen. We are already seen and recorded on the streets, and in trains, in emails, chats, supermarkets, and restaurants. Without a choice, remaining unseen by making a clearer choice where to be seen. We are the brave new now. Get ready to choose your balcony, to escape the warm enclosure of the social web, to address and to talk to the people outside your algorithm bubble. You will not get arrested on the balcony. You and yours should have the right to anonymity on the balcony. Although this might seem technically complicated, the balcony is a gallery, a balustrade, porch, and stoop. The balcony is part of the Ecuadorian embassy. It's masturbating on the balcony when your local dictator passes by. AFK, IRL, BRB, and TTYS. The balcony is the pirate boy memo announcing they will keep up their services by way of drones, or just Pirate Bay completely. Publishing in a 403, publishing inside the referring link, and as error on a server, balconism is IRC, TOR, and ORT, Balcony 2012. Balcony is speed shows, online performances, telecomics, Anonymous, Occupy, and maybe even Google automated cars. Balkanization, not balkanization. The balcony scene creates community rather than commodity. Nothing is to be taken seriously. Every win fails eventually. Proud of web culture and what was built with pun, fun, wires, solder, thoughts, and visions of equality. Nothing is sacred on the balcony. It is lit by screens, fueled by open networks, and strengthened by retweets. On the balcony, the ambitious are high, identities can be copied, and reality manipulated. Hope is given and inspiration created, initiative promoted, and development developed. Know your meme, and meme what you know. I can have balcony. Balconism is the soapbox in the park. The balcony is connected. Stand on a balcony and you will see others. The balcony is connecting. You do not have to be afraid on the balcony. We are behind you. We are the masses. You can feel the warmth from inside, breathing down your neck. Where privacy ceases to feel private, try to make it private. Choose your audience. Demand to know to whom you speak, if not in public, or know when you are talking to an algorithm. When you can, stay anonymous out of principle and fun. And when you're in public, understand in which context and at what time you will and could be seen. Speak out on the balcony, free from the storefront, free from the single white space, but leaning into people's offices, bedrooms, and coffee tables, leaning into virtually everywhere. On the balcony, contemporary art reclaims its communicative sovereignty through constant reminders of a freedom once had on the internet. To the open internet builders and warriors, Learn how to do, then challenge how it is done. Encrypt. Encrypt well and beautifully. Art with too much theory is called auditorium, and kitsch is called living room. Inspired by homebrew technologies and open network communications, create art in the spirit of the internet. Resisting territories, be it institutional and commercial art hierarchies or commercial information hierarchies, the internet is every medium. Head from the information superhighway to the balcony that is everywhere through the right VPN. The pool is always closed.
So thanks for sitting through that brainwash kind of edit of my balconism text. It was there was a moment where I thought, like, this is the best thing I've ever did, just to listen in this room to this. The text just lasts forever. Also, it was nice. This is music. I really liked it when I was listening to it on my headphones. Also, I have to say, the guy that did the voiceover says, instead of the ambitions are high on the balcony, he says the ambitious are high on the balcony. So that's an error. That's it. Thank you.
Yeah, but maybe the ambitions are high on the balcony. Yeah, okay. But depends on how high your balcony is. Okay. What? How are we doing time-wise? Thanks, Constant, also for this piece of balconism. Before we go to kind of general Q&A, I have a couple of questions. I'd like to first come back to you, Stephan, and a pretty obvious question, actually, about some of the things you talked about, like it's okay to be paranoid, for example, and you mentioned some of the agencies like the NSA and so on. So just to clarify a little bit, do you think there is something game-changing about this so-called post-Snowden situation? Or as someone who also thought and worked about these issues of control for a long time?
Now, as I said, the paranoia tells me that I have to be paranoid. Because of what was relieved, and on the other hand, I thought this is actually a quite good way to rule, to have someone, to pay someone like Snowden to reveal these things, because that increases the scare of the of the people, and also the scare of potential terrorists, and everything is. And this is a demonstration of power. Basically, what these documents show us is an immense power to go into every pocket of every human being, even in the brains, and suck them and use them and scan them for bad thoughts, basically. And this kind of it either creates the paranoia or the numbing down effect. And I think, that could be seen that way. And therefore, I want to use my own paranoia to stay alert and not to be numbed down.
All right. Okay. Well, you're introducing the conspiracy theory of Snowden as a double agent, but I don't know. We can maybe come back to. Okay. Yeah.
Doesn't matter. The Snowden case is not the question. Is it a demonstration also of power? It could be seen that way.
So, yeah, Constant, I'd like to ask you about also an aspect of the balcony. I mean, I now would like to excuse myself for asking like three questions in one, but that's because I don't want to seem like I want to kind of deconstruct your argument about balconism, because it kind of leads to perhaps a constructive point in the end. So I couldn't help thinking when reading your text and now listening to it, okay, it was a bit different listening to it with this voice, but that the balcony is a representative space mainly for the privileged addressing a mass, at least that's one aspect of going kind of public on the balcony. So does it mean that you kind of suggest that we are now all somehow privileged to have attention, or maybe we should see it as if we are cursed to having attention of the masses? And if this kind of standing on the balcony is then not on actually only the illusion of attention, as if you are, you know, the masses might be staged just for the dictator, or we might even be the puppet dictators of banana republics when we're there on the balcony. So this suggests maybe perhaps a more dark interpretation of this kind of the balconism and how it allows you to kind of mediate between public and private. And that, coming back to, I mentioned your recent Instagram-related project, that seems for me to be kind of a next step after balconism, to kind of address more the inequality of social networks and attention economy. So do you see what I'm getting at here? And maybe you can comment on that.
Yes, I think, first of all, I'd like to say that there's, I think, the beauty with all this encryption talk lies in the fact that you would still, if there's an encryption with limited amount of access to it, and you would be able to control the access, you would be able to control a culture developing within a certain kind of community, and you would have the possibility for counterculture and for critical culture. And I think this is always necessary, that it wouldn't, this is why you need to develop certain codified languages. So I think this is the importance of holding, like keeping this kind of encryption, and also kind of the danger of this self-censorship, of the fact that people know when they're talking in public or on the balcony, for according to the analogy, that somebody can always hear them, so they start to self-censor themselves. So counterculture or critical culture has less chance to develop due to the self-censorship. And I think that this the relationship to the audience has become very important. Of course, when I left art school, I had to buy an expensive camera so I could make videos to be on or to get accepted on television. Then they were talking about broadcast quality video, and after a while, there was so much video going online that I could sell my camera and just use other people's videos because there was enough. But what I'm trying to say is that the relationship to an audience completely changed. The idea of going through mass media, trying to get access to mass media to acquire an audience for the things you want to say as an artist, completely changed. I think that by now it's much easier to have that access to this audience. And I think even the quantified audience, and that's what happened with my Instagram project, is that there's this quantified audience, so you see how many followers somebody has, and that raises an artificial value or causes a value, like people put in a value to somebody's profile, what they say, like this person's more important because they have more followers. And I looked at that as a hacker. I looked at that as like, that's a vulnerability, that's a social quantification that you can manipulate. So that's, and I manipulated it by buying these 2.5 million Instagram followers and manipulating all the numbers and making Ai Weiwei as important as me, or making Hans Ulrich Obrist as important as other curators and gallerists and whatever, and artists. I mean, they were just equally as important, you know, because it was social capital quantified, but it was also a vulnerability. And the thing is that we're believing in this kind of new technical agency that will give us this kind of quantified social capital, but it's false. So, and the thing is, like with this balcony as well, like if you're saying like these kind of dictators, then the dictators are like we can be on the balcony and we can like be conscious of the audience that we're finding, but the dictators is like Beyonce's butt. That's a dictator, you know, that's like getting all the likes and like feeding into my conversation. Like, why am I like talking about Beyonce's butt? I don't want to, you know, this is like on my feed, this comes through all the social circles. And then anyway, so I think this is the actual real dictator right now. But I think I'm just trying to say is that we should be conscious of the audience that we're addressing, even when we're not addressing it.
that would be a very cheesy handover to the audience, but I think we need to allow a few questions now. I mean, what would be interesting though is to also between the two of you, because you spoke about encryption and you spoke about balconism, and try to perhaps untangle a little bit how balconism in this sense is perhaps a more poetic way to talk about encryption, because encryption is kind of a technical term also at the same time, I mean, PGP and so on, denoting specific standards, but maybe what art can do is also to kind of, you know, come up with these new vocabularies in order to be able to talk about how to be public and private and so on. I don't know if you can comment a bit on that.
Well, I see the metaphor of the balcony more as being between the private and the public, and that you deliberately decide what you want to show to the public and what not. And therefore we come maybe to other metaphors like the mask, or also a kind of of or the performance. But on the other hand, I think I wanted, maybe this is not so directly connected to that, but to a certain ambiguity that we can also observe, maybe with this term, or also with the term encryption, that can, because what I wanted to say, basically what I observe right now in Germany, that through the mask of the satire, for example, or of the cabaret, truth is revealed that is otherwise not revealed. And that, I think, is a strange phenomenon, that maybe through the mask of a comedian, things can become really sort of critical and hit the target of the joke in a much more sophisticated way than kind of activism does, or something like that. Yeah, I mean, we saw that with this Böhmermann Varoufakis thing in this week with the finger. Yeah, that actually the fake finger was, or faking the finger was actually, the double fake was actually that what brought out the truth. And the truth was not, of course, did he show the finger or not, but the whole attitude towards the Greek crisis right now. So I don't know if this makes sense in the context of the balcony, but it's about this kind of what are you willing to show, what kind of mask, what kind of performance are you giving in public, because obviously the public, something happened to the public sphere, and we are still in the middle of these changes, and therefore we have to use art as a kind of to reflect on that.
Can I say something briefly? I just have to say, of course, the web is filled with metaphors. The web itself is a metaphor, of course, for information, chat rooms, superhighway, all these things. So it's, in that sense, like, I think it is a metaphor, which I completely agree is close to a mask. But where I think the spatial analogy is interesting is where, and I would like to give one simple example, which I didn't talk about now, but last year I found this very first picture that was ever photoshopped, and it became this great story, and people distributed this first image that was ever photoshopped. It's a kind of lazy cliche image of a woman on the beach connected to the person that made Photoshop, John Knoll. Anyway, it's a big story, but the attention that was there for this photograph was interesting because it would distribute itself. It was kind of like a meme, because the story that I gave with this picture, it was first like an anecdote on Adobe's website, and then I attached a story to it. But the thing is that this steganography that you also mentioned, I used there to add a layer to this image. So I added a layer to this image that there's the Jennifer in Paradise image is now everywhere, but there are three keys available to get inside of that image and to get the steganographic content out. And what I thought was interesting is using that as a performative space, to use this idea of steganography as a venue, as like an, that you would have a publicly distributed image, but you would still only, if you have a key to it, you get access to another layer and the full comprehension of the intention of the image. And that's only when you would understand the image. And to see that, to connect that to a spatial analogy, I thought was interesting. And then it's, I mean, of course, like there's a lot to say to stop all the spatial analogies for the web or information exchange in general, but I think it still somewhat makes it, at least for me as an artist, makes it easier to make gestures. That's the only thing I wanted to say.
Okay, so I think we have a little bit of time at least for a few questions from the audience, and there's already a question over here and in the back. I don't know who's first.
Did you just yawn, maybe?
Hello? Yeah, here? I have a question to Kristoffer and Transmediale, and as well to Ben, I see you there. How is it possible, or how is it thinkable to use Google Docs, especially on the background or in the age of Snowden, NSA, BND, big data, and so on? Kristoffer, your handling of subscription of journalists to the Transmediale. Journalists have to give up their whole data, post address, mail address, birth, media, and so on, via Google Docs to the Transmediale. And Ben, your talk this morning with using and advertising this software. Thanks.
How is it possible? I have a very pragmatic answer, I suppose. Yeah. I mean, it's a big paradox, and that's, I guess, what we're discussing also. I mean, I wouldn't put Transmediale as a kind of culprit in this discussion, but yeah. It's an uninteresting, I think, in that sense, yeah.
I assume that everything is compromised, and the kind of self-censorship that Constance is talking about. I wouldn't use Tor. I wouldn't use anything that suggested that I was doing to military-industrial complex or anything other, that I'm doing anything underhand. I think there's a kind of black transparency that you can occupy, and I know how to install own cloud and use encryption, all of those things, but I choose not to. It's a choice.
I can only lament the kind of managerial tasks that we have in order to pull off the festival, but with a complex team of different competences and so on. So I can only give the banal, pragmatic answer, although I know how compromised it is, and I would love to discuss it further.
And if I can say something, also, even like, I like the fact, I actually completely sympathize with the fact that, Ben, you're saying that you're not, you're choosing not to, or like that when somebody's choosing not to, but I still think that there needs to be a level of awareness of kind of a critical consumerism, that the fact, like how many conversations I have to go through to tell people that I don't use Skype because I don't ethically support this stupid asshole software. This is like, that takes forever. And then even like to have the awareness that people would maybe understand this completely completely logical decision that you would not want to have to take the measures to protect your communication. I don't know, I think this discussion is really interesting because you need to decide if you want to sympathize, if you want to kind of be on, if you want to support this kind of the people that do need to do this, for example, that do need to encrypt these their communications. And I think that for me now, and this is just personally, I would really like the fact that there's like a more open stance for organizations. Or, for example, we went to the Citizen 4 premiere in London, where Laura Poitras couldn't come, and we were there in the space, and there was the Guardian people that had to destroy the hard drives were sitting in front of us in the space, thanks to my girlfriend Mette Berendsen, who was writing a beautiful article on Laura Poitras. And then Laura was advised not to come there by her lawyers, and then she calls in through Skype, and then like Skype is like the most evil software that got like helped destroy any kind of initiative in the Arab Spring. Anyway, so this is, I don't know, for me there's still like to have that there would be this kind of awareness that we could have this discussion, and where there would be more institutions and like more people would take a stance on that, then these kind of mistakes wouldn't be made. And I think it is the time for not to avoid conscientious decisions, but to have at least a precise discussion. That's so. I think it's good that the question is there to have, like, why would you do this? Like, even if the answer is there, like, well, it was out of just being practical, it's fine. But then it would still be within the reasoning that maybe next time be less practical.
Hi. That's really loud. This is a question. Right now, I want to talk to Stephan first, but I think it's the question I want to ask is open to all three of you. But I just want to start off with paranoia. I'm not sure exactly if you're talking about it as you as an artist and in your practice, but I was wondering if you see it as a solution or, you know, in any sense, a political way of dealing with, you know, an NSA and this era of, like, control and surveillance. Because I would say that I don't really want to live in a world where I am paranoid. I mean, I would think that, like, if I am paranoid, I am not free. And I want to ask if it was naive to believe that a society will be able to control the powers of states through various mediums of imperfect democratic apparatus, or do we need society... Do we, as society, need to resist through tools like encryption? And I also wanted to talk about balkanism. I thought that was really great. And I think it was very good. Another perspective from, I guess, paranoia, in the sense that it's almost like you're hiding in an ocean of other people. It's being aware that, you know, there are billions and billions of people logged on every day, producing, excreting, secreting information all the time, and if you don't have a high profile, why should you care about, you know, if the government, you know, looks at your email? I mean, obviously you should care, and obviously this has a very social impact, a large social impact, I mean, that we can't even foresee right now, but where surveillance means power and control. But what does it mean for encryption when a single person, you know, in the world today, you know, uses their internet for, like, Facebook or YouTube or you know, whatever. What is the incentive for them to encrypt their data or, you know, resist in a way?
Okay, first of all, I think that regarding conspiracy theories, they were all wrong because the conspiracy was larger than life. The NSA conspiracies, basically. I would call myself, however, maybe semi-paranoid, and I like that, because I think it keeps me sharp, and I want to follow these things. And if I connect right to what you said about Skype, I would say it's exactly that is it, that the critical reflection, almost semi-paranoid reflection on questions of Skype and tapping Skype and so forth, will lead to a certain communication, and out of that communication will come a community that discusses these things, and this community then probably has some research-like qualities that then leads to maybe a new and better way of either software or communication, and that again, this new finding in these kind of communities that are created through a problem like this, can then be shared again with others. Maybe not with the NSA, but with others alike. And that's why I think this kind of semi-paranoid whatever can be productive.
Somebody.
Can I just intervene? I don't mean to troll, but it seems like this idea of privacy is actually a very bourgeois idea. And also this, I mean, I'm looking at three white men and this is society. That's what the panel's called. This idea, so I don't own my data. It makes me paranoid. Some people, some of us don't have never owned our own bodies in terms of how it's beheld. And this paranoia of being continuously surveilled and beheld, that this could be the worst thing, that the worst thing is to make, you know, more walls and more kind of boundaries to protect what you have. I mean, also the idea of Beyonce, Beyonce's butt as the dictator, even oppressed by Beyonce's ass. I mean, it's funny, you know. You've got to admit.
Thanks for liking my funny reference.
Yeah, it was great. Thank you. That was my comment.
Sorry, if you talk to me, I think you really haven't followed my talk and understood it. Sorry about that. It's probably my fault.
Okay, so that was the trolling apology before it didn't work. So I would say that there's a next panel after this, and I'm where I think a lot of these questions are raised. And that's a beautiful balcony or stage or things to take a public stance and to take this position, which I thoroughly will enjoy. And then there's also the thing that I would like to say is that as actually a general response, where I would think that, you know, for me it's like taking this kind of position in public. Like, for example, I would just maybe a smaller example. I don't think it's about necessarily like building more walls or making more protection or these kind of things at all. I think there's, for example, in Transmediale, to come back to Transmediale, sorry for that, Kristoffer, but there was a Julian Oliver, not Assange, but Julian Oliver made this, together with Danya, made this IMSI catcher.
Yeah. But it was in 2014, yeah, you mean.
Yeah, sorry, yeah, the year before. And made an IMSI catcher and sent everybody that would be in the HKV, sent an SMS, like, welcome to your new provider, collaborator of the NSA, something like
welcome
that.
Welcome to your new NSA network.
Yeah, and this was preemptively taken out and deinstalled out of a fear that that the police would do it. But the thing is that I think it was always his position is really interesting because he is like an artist, but he's also doing these kind of activist kind of things and technological things. I've been wanting to do that since the beginning. But he does so in public. So when I asked him, like, are you afraid when you're going to be inhibited in your actions and when your agency is going to be taken away, that he was saying that it would be much harder to do so because he's doing that in public. And I think this is also the thing of like raising the awareness and making this conversation more public and taking these positions more deliberately in public. And so I find the argument of like building more walls a bit difficult. So I think, in that sense, because the fact that there's this public communication is available makes people safer, let's say.
Okay, so I think we have to come to a close. Constant, you made a good closing statement already. So, thank you very much, both of you, and to you for listening.